If that music doesn't hit you hard in the nostalgias, I don't know what will. But not to worry, we've got your fix. Today we're taking an old Game Boy we bought from eBay and we're giving it a full makeover. I'm going to show you how to repair a screen with dead pixels, completely replace a dead screen, how to replace capacitors, and how to replace corroded battery terminals. I'll start by removing the 6 tri-point screws, starting with the ones inside the battery compartment. Nintendo uses tri-point screws for the exterior shell of their devices, not a common screw type, but nothing my Protec Go can't deal with. The two halves of the Game Boy shell should separate now, but before we can take them fully apart, we'll need to disconnect the LCD ribbon cable. Looking at the screen half of this device, you can see that the speaker and its two connectors are fully in view. First, I'll remove all the Phillips screws, which should let me remove the entire PCB and speaker as a single assembly. You might need to pry the board a little here. The frame of the screen has a bit of glue that does peel away with a bit of gentle pressure. Now, if you have a blown out speaker, you can easily perform that repair right here without further disassembly. Grab a soldering iron, I'm using my iFixit smart soldering iron, some flux, and a bit of copper braid. Desolder the connections on the speaker. Remove the speaker and pop in a new one. I'm gonna lay down some flux and a bowl of solder on each contact and I'll go ahead and solder on the wires one by one. If you're still having audio problems after replacing the speaker, stick around and we'll talk about another fix later in the video. Let's take a look at that screen next. I'm reinserting the LCD cable and powering on the device. As you can see, we have several lines on the left-hand side of the screen which are either caused by ripped traces or disconnected solder joints. If you're lucky, it's the latter. Go ahead and remove the rubber guard at the base of the LCD. Set your iron to about 280 degrees Celsius or about 530 Fahrenheit and briefly touch the point right where the screen is faulty. Don't leave your iron on here for more than a second or two and go as far up and close to the screen as you can without touching it. This takes some patience and back and forth. Never touch the same spot more than a couple of times consecutively, but with some luck, you might be able to preserve your original Game Boy LCD. If that fails or your screen is just outright dead, you can order an aftermarket LCD that's designed to simulate the original Game Boy's pixelation and color scheme. They usually come with a new speaker and LCD controller. These screens are good insofar as they're modern LCDs that outperform the original, but they're not 100% faithful to the style of the original LCD, which is no longer in production. For a true one-to-one reproduction of pixels, you'll either have to find a salvaged screen, or, the next best thing, you can opt for a mod retro chromatic. You'll find that teardown on our YouTube channel. While you're here, you might want to replace the scratch-prone plastic LCD cover on the front of the case. Apply a little isopropyl alcohol to the edges, let it soak, then gently push the plastic out from the other side. You might find some severely aged and petrified glue in here which you'll need to scrape away. Once cleaned off, set the parts aside for later. With the screen and speaker replacements complete, it's time to look at the mainboard half of the device and have a chat about capacitors. These electrolytic capacitors have varying shelf lives. They could last 10 years or more, but sooner or later they're gonna pop or leak or find some other way to lose their capacitance. Luckily, capacitor kits are cheap as chips. You can buy pre-assembled kits or go the DIY route and buy a larger selection of capacitors and pull what you need. Pop caps will present various symptoms depending on which cap has gone bad. From no audio to no power, it's worth looking over each cap to see if they're in good condition. You'll want to remove the mainboard to get a good look at the capacitors and the general state of the board. That means more Phillips screws. Luckily, all of these screws are the same length, so don't worry about sorting them. Replacing the through-hole caps is a simple matter of desoldering the old caps and popping in a new one of the same value. With any luck, replacing the caps should get your system working again. If not, you might need to take a look at other advanced repairs, which is beyond the scope of this video. Quite often you'll find the positive and negative terminals of these Game Boys corroded. That's because at some point someone gave Zelda a whirl and forgot to remove the AA alkalines for like 5 months, which over time expand and leak, leading to this nasty mess you see before you. Luckily, the replacement contacts are cheap and easy to find. Place the mainboard upside down on a flat surface and set your iron to around 400 degrees Celsius. Apply heat to the contact point till the solder melts, then using a pair of tweezers, apply gentle downward force. If it won't budge, apply more heat. Don't yank these out or you'll rip traces and damage the PCB. Go ahead and repeat the same process on the other battery terminal. Clean the surface and apply a bit of flux to the contacts. Apply a ball of solder and using your tweezers, insert the new terminal while applying heat to the solder ball. Check your work, add additional solder if needed, and repeat on the other side. I went ahead and used some Retro-Brite to clean up the plastic too. And there you go, you can't argue with the results. I don't know about you, but the combination of a repair and a game of Tetris really hits the spot. Don't take my word for it though, go fix one for yourself.